Let's continue our conversation with the former congressman from Illinois, from Chicago specifically, Michael Patrick Flanagan, currently the president of Flanagan Consulting. Mike, before the break, before we were rudely interrupted there, you were talking about Henry Hyde. You guys were on the floor, and our late great friend said that compromise is the business of Congress. I appreciate the point you're making. What I found to be the case, however, is that Washington defined compromise by Republicans and conservatives caving in to what the Democrats and the Washington press corps wanted to see happen. So how do you have effective compromise in Washington?
Well, that's a great question. And you, of course, are exactly correct. Compromise from the president's point of view is you come to my point of view, and then we will agree, and then we have compromise when he didn't move an inch. And this is the CEO mentality. And I'm not so sure that that's a bad attitude for a president to have. It's a terrible attitude for a Senate majority leader to have. It's a terrible attitude for a member of the House to have. The business is to take care of your constituency. And I don't want to get too lost in theory here, but you know, I don't think I ever voted with Mrs. Pelosi once when I was there. But the 750,000 people she represents on the floor of Congress have just as much right to have their view represented as my people did. And that's why the art of compromise is important, is because we all work for the common good and the interest of 300 million Americans, not just the ones that agree with us right now. And so you move, when you're in the majority, you move the needle in your direction incrementally. You can't have all the votes at once. And I think the biggest difficulty with the Tea Party class right now, great guys all, great gals all, is that they come from the CEO class. They're not long in politics. I wasn't, you weren't either, JD, but they don't have a background in politics, and they don't have a background in compromise. They're from the CEO class. They make a decision, decision happens. And their kind of view is, we have the votes, let's vote and get it done. When you do that, you get stuff like the Affordable Care Act. You've got to get both sides involved, and you've got to get a good piece of legislation that we can all agree with. And that's hard to do.
Of course, the president has to sign it. And while president, regardless of party, can say, I'm standing right here in the final analysis, there does have to be some compromise from 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. Now, we saw it, ironically, with Bill Clinton eventually during our time in Washington, but Mr. Obama shows no inclination. Is he going to surprise us these last 2 years, or is he just locked in ideologically and attitudinally as the CEO who doesn't move?
Yeah, great question. I think Mr. Obama showed he understands the concept, because if you remember when the Affordable Care Act was moving, they ridiculed him regularly for not taking the leadership and not defining what the bill should be and not forcing through a big government solution. And he said, no, Congress needs to work its will and provide a bill to me that I can sign. His attitude on that will be completely different when the Congress isn't dominated by Democrats but dominated by Republicans, and his attitude will be, you know, Dr. No, he'll veto everything that comes across his way. I don't see him seeing it our way on any level, to any degree. It's going to be 2 years of very difficult times in dealing with the White House.
2 minutes remaining. We want to call on your expertise as a Chicago guy. This curious report released by Judicial Watch that Oprah Winfrey was targeted, or at least her Chicago studio, was the target of a terrorist attack that thankfully was foiled. According to the report, the terrorists were planning to bring a U-Haul full of explosives there to the front of her studio and blow it up. Apparently, one of the guys is detained and now in the slammer in El Paso. Chicago as a terror target and Oprah as a terror target.
Well, Disney got a no-fly zone over all their parks. Maybe we should have a mobile no-fly zone over Oprah. Wherever she goes, we'll just have a big circle around her where you can't fly over her. And have her chauffeur hooked into air traffic controllers everywhere that can't fly over Oprah. Harpo Studios is in Chicago. It's on the West Loop. It's a two-story building. It would have been a disaster if a truckload of explosives showed up there and would have hurt a lot of people. But I don't think Oprah was the target. I think it was the collection of people that are around Oprah that was the target. If Oprah were the target, she wouldn't be with us now. She's not exactly a hard target to get to.
Well, thankfully, she's not, and we're all grateful. You know that the thing of visibility.
Yes, absolutely.
She's a talented woman. But Chicago, you know, for years, Mike, they called it the second city. If nothing else, is this a reminder that terrorists take a look at major metropolitan areas like your hometown as a target?
And the Willis Tower, formerly the Sears Tower, was actually a target, as well as Oprah. And, you know, as the tallest building in the United States, or there's some new category that it fits in. It's big, it's bulky, it's heavy, it's muscular, it's Chicago. That's the kind of thing that we should be more focused on, I think, than providing specific safety measures for specific famous personalities from terrorist attacks. I think we have to kind of be vigilant about everything all the way around. And I, of course, join the world in the happy that Oprah was unharmed, but also that the people at Harpo Studios were unharmed.
And that Chicago averted an attack. Mike Flanagan, thanks so much.